I want to catch all the red-eye tetras from this tank because I want to put them in another aquarium because this tank, I just don't like it with all this random action in it. There's no methodical, it's just too random in this tank. But the red-eye tetras that are in here are a really cool surface schooling fish, meaning they do school together and they typically spend most of their time near the surface of the aquarium. We also have some threadfin rainbows, we got some blue tetras, and then we have some dwarf rainbow fish in there. So wish me luck getting them out. This is for one of the 40-gallon aquariums that you guys have not seen yet. I suppose I should show you that before we catch these fish. So you guys know the 40-gallon tanks are out here when we first walk out. This is the one we're adding them to. We're gonna look at that here in a second, but there's a couple of things that I wanna show you and talk about. This tank infected all of these tanks with hair algae, especially the puffer tank. Many of you guys were asking about this and wanted an update. The plants and everything is doing good, and the hair algae is starting to die off. I haven't done a water change in a few days, so it looks way worse than it actually is. But what happens is, every time I do a water change and manually remove all of this algae, it comes back less and less and less and less, and this is actually looking really good. I also need to add in some more flow to this tank. I'm gonna put in some Corydoras and maybe some top-dwelling fish, just to add some more life to this. And puffers were moved out of here, a few of them. I think there's only 10 in here now. But this tank then infected this tank. And the same idea, all I gotta do is siphon the hair algae out. I mean, this tank looks good though. If we take a look, a step back here, this one has it way worse than the other one, but it's just a nutrient imbalance. It's not that big of a deal. I set these tanks up with no idea what I wanted to do for fish, and you know, it just got out of control. I never got the tank balanced in time, but when you do a plant a tank and you're dosing it and whatnot, algae's gonna happen. But you know, these are the types of things that, you know, pro scapers don't want you to see or show, because this is more relatable and this is actually what happens in an Aquarius aquarium. And then we got this tank down here. I hate it. I absolutely despise it. Yeah, the plants look, be quiet. Yeah, the plants are doing well. Yeah, I mean, it's got hair algae as well. I mean, it's horrible. I'm gonna redo this tank. In fact, I might even redo all of these tanks besides this one and this one. These two are really good. I really like them. We'll get to this one here in a second. This tank, I'm gonna do a massive water change, clean up the hair algae, and then I'm gonna put some fish in there. Probably gonna add some shell dwellers or something. But we also just recently set up and scaped two more tanks in the house for the podcast area. You guys have been asking when you're gonna do those. I actually just put out a new episode to the podcast today. Highly suggest you guys check it out. Link will be in the description most likely. Anyways, this tank will probably stay the same. I just gotta clean it up. That tank, complete redo. But I have a lot of other things I'm working on you guys don't know about, so it's kind of taking precedence. Anyways, this tank really took off. If I can show you just kind of how it's set up originally, you know, I took these pieces of wood here and kind of made them intertwined, a little bit of hair algae in here, no big deal. That's going to go away as soon as I add in some fish and get this tank properly cycled, etc., etc. I just added in some cycled media. We're going to boost it up a little bit with some beneficial bacteria, but as you can see, the plants are actually doing really, 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 really well. And I love this tank. Look at this kind of starting to come across here. All the plants are doing fantastic in here. Not a massive growth spurt, but they are doing what they're supposed to be doing, which is growing. None of them are melting. They're all looking quite well. I ended up adding in scrap plants here and there. Originally, it was just gonna be this plant over here and this type of plant here. And what I wanted was this side, you can almost see a path originally before the plants overtook it, but I wanted this side to all be grass and this side to all be that other plant there. And then I added in some scrap plants that I had, like in the back there, up here, there, and everything's just kind of taking off. But wouldn't this look good with, you know, 10, 15 top-dwelling tetras and then maybe some bottom dwellers of, maybe we add in some of those Epistogramma that we have in the quarantine tank. They can't go in yet. They still have a couple more weeks of quarantine or so, but you know, maybe we add in some shrimp and maybe we skip the Epistogramma. Bottom line is this. I don't have to go out and buy any more fish because we have so much fish out here. For the next little while, I'm just gonna kind of reorganize, move things around. Look at the piranha. I don't know if you guys can see it because the damn saltwater tank is lighting it up, but they're always out. Pretty cool, eh?
Look who else is out.
Somebody wants to eat. Anyways, I'm going to catch these fish and put them in. And when I say that, that's the intention. I don't know if I'm going to actually be able to catch them. But I do know that for the most part, they'll still stay near the top of the aquarium. Look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I just caught 6 in one net. Like I said, these guys are top-dwelling tetras. They are a schooling fish, the red-eyed tetra. If you're looking for a common fish that's... They're not that pretty because they're not that colorful, but if you want true schooling action, a lot of the times the red-eyed tetras in the right tank will do so. It'll be interesting to see how they act in a smaller aquarium, but we'll go from there and we'll get there in a minute. Yeah, so you'll see the other fish, when the net went in, they all darted towards the bottom of the tank, where the red eyes kind of stayed to the top. If you can even see that, this tank has beard algae in it, but I'm doing an experiment video. That's why we're not updating on this. I'm filming a bunch of stuff. I'm not even gonna spoil what I'm doing, but it's intentional to a degree. So, like I said, yeah, being a schooling fish, they're technically, and a top dweller, they're technically the easiest fish to catch in here. Because they stay near the top, and all I'm doing is making sure no other types of fish in there. They stay near the top, kind of stick together, so every time I chase them around, I'm catching 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. I'm literally catching 6. I don't intentionally mean to catch 6. I wonder if they intentionally mean to be caught at 6 at a time. I might leave some in here, but that 40 gallon might also just become a tank just for these guys. Who really knows? I need to see what it looks like, but I do know this is the right choice. This is the only tetra that I know that does this. When the red-eyed tetra gets scared, look what they do. Get you out of the light there. Maybe they'll do it again. But when they get scared, like, so if you had a bucket full of tetras like this, they just lay there, or they just like kind of swim around. But if we give them a minute, and kind of, if they're a little stressed out, they will play dead. They'll lay on their sides. In my opinion, when it comes to tetras, the schooling type tend to be the most intelligent and the smartest. For example, look at the rest of these fish. I was just in there darting around with the net trying to catch them. They're acting like they don't care right now. The red eyes are hugged to the bottom, staying together, hiding. They're starting to come out a little bit now, but a minute ago they were kind of by the bottom, and they don't do that typically. Stay near the top. If you're looking for a really cool schooling, get a red-eyed tetra. They're not the best. Same with like any schooling tetra. There's true schooling tetras, and then there's shoaling tetras, where you could just add a bunch of tetras and they kind of stay together, but they're not a schooling fish. They shoal. Schooling would be, they swim in directional patterns. They're always together. They swim one way, swim the other way. They're always swimming together. And shoaling meaning a piranha shoals, so they like to be around their own kind, but they don't necessarily always swim in the same direction. Depends on what you're looking to accomplish. It's relatively simple to catch them because they kind of do stick together, but they will dart and hide into the moss and whatnot, so we might not be able to get them all today. That's enough stressing out of the fish for one day. I do plan to move them all over, but as you can see, like when they get a little bit stressed out and they don't want to be caught, they're just gonna hide, so I'm not going to make it any worse than it already is. But yeah, they'll dart into the moss, they'll hide, they'll lay down. I know there's at least 6 left in there. I could see them, but we have 15 in the bucket, so let's add them to the tank. Now, as you guys know, we built the filtration in behind this aquarium. I also lowered the water level a little bit because we're just gonna dump them in with the bucket, but get you guys back a little bit so you can see. We're gonna be using some Turbo Start by Fritz to get this, make sure that it's cycled properly. Although the sponge that's behind it, I had those in the aquariums floating for a few weeks to get them seeded with bacteria, but this is just going to make it a lot easier, and guarantee it's ready to go. I'll make the tank a little cloudy for now, but that's fine. The thing I like about these little bottles is they're rated for 50 gallons. These are 40 gallons. I just go ahead and dump the whole thing in. Yeah, they're gonna be awesome in here. Ready? Yeah, I'll add 6 more in, and these guys will look incredible. Yes, I think these guys are going to do pretty awesome in this tank, but they need to kind of settle in and whatnot. A lot of them just started back behind there. They're not a tetra that you would typically expect to do this kind of thing. Most tetras will just automatically, but these guys are highly intelligent. Look, they're all already hiding. It's very uncommon to see this in tetras for the most part. Usually it's like cichlids that are this smart, or like puffers and whatnot. These guys are so adorable. A lot of them spend their time over there. I don't know what they're doing over there because I can't see because that massive rock, but who knows? I know they're just babies though, and a lot of them are hiding, but they're doing well in here. Needs more fish. Anyways, these guys make me wonder if I did the right stocking in the 2000. You see, it would have been awesome if we didn't have the archers, first and foremost. I didn't think I'd have to say that, but this tank probably be pretty cool without the archers. Archers made it really unique, and they're getting really big, but wouldn't it be a lot cooler if there was like 200 of those red-eyed tetras schooling at the top of the surface? I think that would have been amazing. But on that same note, the archer fish are really getting bigger, really looking cool, and at some point, we'll be able to get them to start spitting. They probably do it now, actually, especially since I adjusted the flow of the water up top. Yeah, these little tanks inspire me for these bigger tanks. Like, I'm really getting back into community fish at this point. I'll never leave the monster fish area or the arena, but look at these Severums. Look at the reds and they're just getting so big. Gorgeous, aren't they? And the Waru, of course. Just monstrous in here. They got way bigger now that they're in this big tank. But everybody's doing fine. There's the barbs over there. You guys love these. The denizens. Angels. I think we'll eventually add in the discus. A ton of Corydora. And what else did I want to put in there? Oh, the whatchamacallits. It's too many names out here right now. I got a lot going on. I just uploaded a podcast and I'm wondering how it's doing and what everybody thinks because it's hilarious. So my mind's over there right now, obviously. Shoot. What the hell are they called? Oh, the Festivums. Oh, when my mind goes, it goes. Anyways, yeah, I think we'll end up putting the discus in there as well. These guys are pretty low-grade discus, but, you know, who knows what they'll end up looking like once they're full-grown and whatnot. But they're all doing quite well. How many is in there? 10? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They're behind here, too, 9, 10. But anyways, looking fantastic. This tank needs a nice little cleaning. Such an easy tank. The trigger is knocking down some of the coral, as you can see right there. This is, where'd the trigger go? Where'd you go? Where are you? Oh, he's right in front of me. He's the only one to worry about at this point. All the, look at the yellow tangs, all, like, almost back to 100%. There's, like, one that doesn't look that great, but, you know, little veggies in its diet and whatnot, and it'll look good. So I might have to move some of the coral around. You need to chill out. He just jumped. Move a little bit of the coral around. The lights actually just came on out here. Like, he'll tip some things over. But, move some of the coral around and things will be great. Look at the anemones. Whew, I love this tank. I think you guys do too. Yeah, beauty. Quarantine area, lights haven't come on yet. It's all on timers and I don't mess with their cycles very much unless I gotta make a video specifically about them, but I know some people are like, Joe, you gotta have the lights on for a little while because every video I'm always like, oh, lights just came on, lights just came on. And it's true because I'll come out here when I feel like making a video and I'll turn them on and then I start making the video. So a lot of the times we don't get to see their natural behavior because I'm a fool and I don't prepare for my videos at all. I just come out, grab the camera and we go. I don't even know what I'm gonna be saying. Look at the pothos though. That's all doing well. I've been adding it to every tank. And eventually I think it's going to cover the entire back wall. I'll just have to raise the lights up so the pothos can get some of it. But you can see this one here, now watch the roots. I've been adding pothos and showing you guys how to do that for, I think the first time I showed it on camera was like 10 years ago. But fantastic plant that if you put the roots in it, it's gonna suck up a lot of nutrients in the tank. Look at this tank with all the anubias. It's like an Anubias paradise. I have to keep splitting it and moving it, splitting it and moving it, splitting it and moving it. All of it's doing really well. There's a few different species of Anubias in here. I could clean the glass, I guess, before I make a video. Look at the front toes, how big they're getting. Pure beauts. Yeah, we might as well look at a few of the fish since I'm out here. I don't mind looking at them. Everybody's doing good. Everybody's doing fine. I know, like, some people are like, you haven't shown this for a while or that for a while. Especially when it came to the 40s, I was like, I'm not done with them. And I don't want to ruin it, but now I'm too far behind on videos because I've been working on that podcast tirelessly, if, I don't know if that's a word. And all I kind of do, come out here, feed the fish, do my water changes. I spend a lot of time out here just watching my fish. I've been doing that a lot more over the past year than previously, just focused on that. You know, I can't let YouTube run my life, and although I did for many years. I don't know, I'm enjoying the podcast and conversations and stuff, but I'm actually working on something big, 5 times bigger than the current gallery, so if you think I'm not doing enough, or if you think I've lost touch, or not focused or whatever, I'm working on something 5 times bigger than the aquarium gallery, and we'll see what happens there, and if it comes to fruition and whatnot, but, you'll notice that the tree, I've cut it down. So it just goes to the top of the tank there. I did that for 2 reasons. One, the humidity was just too much out here. It was crippling. Plus, it just looked kind of weird. The tank does have to be covered in the winter. This summer, I'll be able to take it off. But the humidity and the evaporation from this tank was so great. It was just absolutely disgusting out here if I didn't cover this up. Because it's warm out here. I heat the room. This is warm. It's just too much. Okay, side story. The reason why I think I don't spend much time on these ones is because I think I want to remove them. Move them out of the way. Like, move them from this area. Maybe I can line the back of that tank with tanks, with 40s. These ones will stay here. But those ones, I think what I want to do here is build a massive filter right here that you can see into that runs this tank. And then the 2000 will get the filtration room back there. But it's summertime now, so I can actually do a lot of these things. In the winter, it's hard. I don't have anywhere to build in my house to build big things. I can't build outside in the winter because there's, you know, several feet of snow. So when it comes to the gallery, I don't like to build too much because, you know, what if a piece of wood goes flying or something happens and a tank smashes? These are glass. I mean, I could throw whatever I want at the acrylic aquarium. That's not going to break. I could do anything I want to this, like literally drop kick it. Nothing's going to happen. It's bulletproof. But when it comes to glass, I don't trust it nearly as much as I do acrylic. Anyways, I'm rambling. I'm treating this like it's a podcast. I hope you guys enjoyed the video and the new tank and whatnot. I've got so many videos I gotta show you. Anyways, if you're not subscribed to this channel yet, you wanna see more of this stuff, make sure you subscribe. Also check out the podcast channel. About to hit 20,000 subscribers within its first month of being out. Absolutely incredible. Thank you guys for that. See you guys in the next one.